안녕하세요, 원다입니다.
Perhaps the most surprising part of the terminological exploration, righteous or righteousness or rectitude, was a long-term trait in Joseon foreign policy, policymaking in general, but specifically foreign policy.
한국 외교 정책의 특징은 올바름, 정의, 정직이다 라고 말하고 있는 하버드 대학 교수. 이것이 이번 학술 탐사에서 발견한 가장 놀라운 부분이라고 말하고 있는데요. 올바름, 의, 정직. 한국 사회에서는 너무 당연한 이것이 세계 최고 대학이라고 불리는 이곳에서 가장 놀라운 발견이라고 하는 이유는 무엇일까요? 이 발언은 하버드 대학 학술회에서 사회를 맡고 있는 교수가 오드 아르네 웨스타드 교수의 지난 강의를 짧게 설명하는 중에 한 발언의 일부였습니다. 오드 아르네 웨스타드 교수의 강의를 듣고 놀란 사람들이 또 있는데요. 바로 중국 중심의 역사 교육을 배워왔던 사람들이었습니다. 예일대학교는 중국 베이징에 예일대 베이징 센터를 설립하고 그 분야 전공자들에게 유명 교수의 강의를 들을 수 있도록 하고 있는데요. 지난 9월 22일 오드 아르네 웨스타드 교수의 강의를 들은 중국 역사 전공자들은 충격에서 헤어나오지 못하며 웨스타드 교수에게 여러 가지 질문을 합니다. 그들이 지금까지 배워온 역사와 웨스타드 교수가 말하는 역사는 너무 달랐으니까요. 유교의 시작이 중국이었으니 당연히 중국이 더 유교적인 국가인 줄 알았는데 웨스타드 교수는 한국을 더 올바른 국가라고 말합니다. 그리고 한국은 중국의 속국이라고만 배워왔는데 웨스타드 교수는 한국이 외교를 잘해서 오히려 중국을 컨트롤해왔다고 말합니다. 한국이 중국에게 조공을 바쳤으니 속국이라는 말이 맞다고 여기는 중국인들에게 웨스타드 교수는 조공은 일종의 체제였을 뿐 속국과는 상관이 없다고 말합니다. 웨스타드 교수의 강의를 듣고 충격에 휩싸인 중국인들이 어떤 질문을 던지고 또 어떤 대답을 듣게 되었을까요? 9월 22일자 강의의 질의응답 부분 중 일부를 발췌하여 번역해보았습니다. 함께 보시죠.
Hi, I'm from Beijing. So my question is that a lot of research has been done in these areas. So I was wondering how is the professor's research and how his book different from others? What kind of different angle he can see that we don't see? Say, what kind of different point of view the Chinese scholar don't see and he sees that?
It's a good question. I think in cultural terms, that has been dealt with reasonably successfully, I think, by other authors, not least Chinese historians and scholars. But in political and ideological terms, perhaps a little bit less so, is this very complicated relationship between the empire and the nation. So why is the Chinese imperial state's relationship to Korea so different from what you would find to China's relationship to other states, other countries, other groups, peoples in the region? Why is there no attempt at colonization or colonial settlement? Why is there so little interference over a long period of time by the central imperial authorities towards Korea during this period? That is which is very relevant, I think, for today, which is the very successful management of the imperial center that the Korean leaders carried out over generations. So some of that you will see in action today as well. Koreans knew much more about China than vice versa, and were able to employ that knowledge, that tradition, that background, in order to gain advantages.
So I was wondering, is there any areas that you find the Chinese scholar ignored and you find it's actually quite important?
I think many Chinese scholars have a tendency to look more at the China side than the Korea side of this relationship. I mean, particularly with regard to how the imperial framework worked. I mean, it's not only true for Chinese scholars, it's also true for some Western scholars. So I do think that there is, including in today's China, a sort of dissonance with regard to this. It was very interesting. I gave a talk at Beida about this project, which led to some really interesting discussions between Korean and Chinese students about how Korean history and the relationship between the two is actually understood in China, and how it's taught at a university like Beida. I thought that was quite interesting.
Okay, thank you.
I wonder, can I relate your idea to the trade history, to the tributary system, change to the treaty system in the 19th century?
for some time been of the opinion that you have to be a little bit careful with the concept of a tributary system. There's definitely tribute involved in most of China's foreign relations with surrounding countries, meaning that the leaders of these countries, in order to have any kind of relationship with the Ming or the Qing, would have to appear in Beijing or Nanjing for a short period at the imperial court with gifts that were presented and to show their subservience to the imperial center. So tribute, yes. System, of that I'm less certain. One of the things that both the Ming and especially the Qing were very good at was to deal with different neighboring countries differently, according to the kind of format that existed in the relationship between the empire and the states. So the idea that there is a kind of centralized format, sort of one size fits all, at least basic approach that is there in the form of a tribute system, is something I'm skeptical of. I like to joke that of the tribute system, that I always argue that the tribute system has been stronger at Harvard than what it's ever been in China. And I think that is true to some extent. So we have to study all of these relationships today and in history individually. We have to look at what is this for China's borders. So the wider world is a different story. But if you look at these countries that China has interacted with for a very long period of time, there isn't a kind of one-size-fits-all approach. One of the strengths of China's approach has been that these countries are dealt with, as the Qing would have said, according to their own characteristics. Right? The differences are as important as the similarities. And that was part of the success, frankly, from a Chinese perspective, that they were able to break out of this idea that everyone should be dealt with similarly. They all have to be dealt with according to their own characteristics. So the idea that you do not differentiate is entirely wrong in this sort of hierarchical approach that existed for relations in traditional China.
I guess my personal interest or bent tends to be more on the cultural, philosophical, intellectual side. Mm-hmm. I find it curious your choice of your title and starting right away with Righteous Nation, you know, and the influence of Confucianism. And you hear it often said that Korea is a much more Confucius country than China is now. So I guess I'm curious how explicit or implicit are these effects of Confucianism on, I guess, South Korea, North Korea, and China? Mm-hmm. And sort of how do you see that impacting the way they relate with each other, as well as how the U.S. does or does not understand how to deal with them?
The understanding of this particular moral philosophical universe from an American perspective is very, very limited. Someone was asking me during one of the Harvard lectures how I would define the difference between Confucianism and Neo-Confucianism, and say that Neo-Confucianism is Confucianism for human beings. It's about finding rules and practical rules and regulations whereby you develop a society and build a state. And that, I think, has been over a long period of time more visible in Korea, as we indicated earlier on, than anywhere else. Ming was pretty Neo-Confucian in terms of its orientation, but it pales in comparison with the Joseon experience, in which this Neo-Confucian corpus of thinking was everything. I think quite a lot of that remains in Korea, but in different forms. So, you know, just like any other so I would call it social philosophy, or for that matter, religion, or whatever you want to bring into the mix. It doesn't come just in one form. I mean, there are different ways of understanding this and different ways of emphasizing it. North Korea emphasizes the hierarchical approach, right? That is there. In many ways, not surprising that North Korea has become the world's first dynastic communist state. I mean, that is the influence of this particular Neo-Confucian background. But also in South Korea, very interestingly. So one of the things that you find many South Koreans emphasizing is self-cultivation as a part of the Confucian background. So the idea that you're responsible not just for yourself, but for your society and eventually your state. So during the protest in South Korea against the dictatorship, particularly the student protest, you saw a great deal of that, right? That these, you're not just responsible to yourself and to your family, you're responsible for your whole society. And if you look at China back then, you find a society that is much further removed from these Confucian roots than what Korea would be, either north or south. Confucianism has had a, in a certain form, has had a bit of a renaissance in China, but it's still, to some extent, cut off from those roots, right, in the earlier phase.
한국인들은 지금까지 나 자신뿐만 아니라 가족 그리고 사회, 더 나아가 국가를 위해 책임을 다하는 것을 너무나 당연한 일이라 여겨왔습니다. 하지만 오드 아르네 웨스타드 교수는 한국에서만 일어나는 일이라고 말하고 있습니다. 지난 수백 년간 생활 속 깊숙이 자리 잡고 있던 한국식만의 유교가 지금은 자기 소양을 강조하는 방식으로 한국 사회에서 발현되고 있다고 웨스타드 교수는 말하고 있습니다. 한국에서 펼쳐지는 일상들이 해외에 소개되었을 때 많은 외국인들이 놀라움을 금치 못한다는 소식을 들으면 한국인들은 그저 그건 지나친 국뽕조장 뉴스일 뿐이라고 치부해왔습니다. 하지만 오드 아르네 웨스타드 교수의 이야기를 듣고 보니 해외에서 그런 반응이 나올 수도 있겠다는 생각이 들었습니다. 그곳은 한국과 다르게 올바름을 위한 자기 수양을 강조하는 곳이 아니니까요. 한국인에게는 너무나 당연한 일들이 외국에서는 당연하지 않은 일이라는 것을 이제 우리는 받아들여야 하나 봅니다. 시청해주셔서 감사합니다. 원다였습니다.